Simon & Schuster Audio presents Public Parts, How Sharing in the Digital Age Improves the Way We Work and Live by Jeff Jarvis. Read by the author.
Introduction, The Ages of Publicness. A footnote. No, publicness is not a word in most dictionaries. I don't care. We invent words and remix definitions every day. Its once appropriate synonym, publicity, has come to mean public relations, a phrase that itself has been freighted with marketing meaning. So please allow me to define the word. Publicness. One, the act or condition of sharing information, thoughts, or actions. Two, gathering people or gathering around people, ideas, causes, needs, making a public. Three, opening a process so as to make it collaborative. Four, an ethic of openness. Facebook, my son Jake told me, was my favorite part of high school. I don't think I had a favorite part of high school. Jake's class of 2010 was the first to use Facebook after it expanded past colleges in 2005. It extended their school life around the clock. In my youth, that would have been a formula for the infinite loop of hell. My adolescent years were dominated by hormonal high drama, a desert of irony, and social awkwardness I dare not recall or I will cringe into a small ball, all alleviated by some good friends and a few great teachers. But for Jake, Facebook allowed him to build and maintain relationships with more friends more of the time. For the Facebook class of 2010, school became a more social experience, a good experience. As far as I'm concerned, that's a miracle. Facebook's founder, Mark Zuckerberg, is Jake's role model, his hero even. Jake is in college, studying computer science and entrepreneurship. While still in high school, he used his skills to write Facebook apps, turning one of them into a business he sold. Zuckerberg left college to combine these disciplines and create one of the two great corporations setting the course for our next age. I wrote about the other company in my last book, What Would Google Do? Just as Google built an industry around search, Facebook is at the core of its own new industry built on sharing. It is enabling and exploiting our explosive desire to connect with one another. And it is causing us to ask, as individuals and as societies, what should be private, and what should be public, and why? This book is not a sequel to the last. It is not What Would Facebook Do? It is a study of our emerging age of publicness. Here, I will examine the profound change that is overtaking us, presenting us with questions, fears, and opportunities. I will focus on the opportunities. If my teen years were socially stunted, I'm making up for it in middle age. I have Jake to thank for much of that. He is the webmaster of my blog and my secret weapon in understanding the social age. He schooled me in the norms and values of Facebook society. He's the one who made me pay attention to Twitter, which has made writing this book at once harder, causing constant distraction with the siren call of the conversation that never ends, but also easier, as I always have researchers and editors at the ready. At this moment, I'm at my laptop, trying to catalog the benefits of publicness. As a reflex, I turn to Twitter and ask people there what new and valued relationships they've made because they are open and public. In moments, answers flow. At John Blanton says he found his wife via chat. Lesbian comic and speaker At Heather says, coming out brought me integrity, less fear, and more energy. An old friend, At Terry Heaton, says, it helps avoid a lot of losers when dating. At FLM Parada found a job. At Gina Trapani created a career. At Everywhere Trip says he has met people all over the world because I let people know where I am on Twitter, Facebook, and blog. At AK Stanwyck says that on her last trip to NYC, I made a point of meeting in person three folks with whom I'd bonded on Twitter. In multiple tweets, At Alexis Rule says that she found most of my friends from high school, some from college, and discovered that people I might not have liked 15 years ago have become wonderful friends, and I cherish them all now. At Siva Vide, the author of The Googleization of Everything and a frequent, though friendly, sparring partner of mine in panels and posts, responds to my question about forming valued relationships, tweeting, "How about you and me?" Because I am public, I've made new friends and reconnected with old ones. I have received work and made money, including this book and the last. I have tested ideas, spread those ideas, and gotten credit and blame. I'll echo at Dustberry, who answered my question on Twitter by saying, "The best part about being public is that I can't BS anymore. Too many are in a position to call me on it. Makes life easier." Ditto at J.M. Hagen. Being public led to my mantra of honesty. I am who I am all the time because, being public, lies have thin shadows. Politicians and corporations could learn from that tweet. At Clint Hartson says he used Twitter and publicness to confess what he eats and weighs. That, plus self-determination, has lost me 65 pounds. Not to be outdone, I have written about my malfunctioning penis. More on that later, I'm sure you'll be glad to know. And received invaluable advice in return from fellow prostate cancer patients. Being public helps me get information and make decisions. I have learned that the more we share, the more we benefit from what others share. I am a public man. My life is this open book. Privacy advocates say I should be wary. They say I shouldn't open up so much. These privacy advocates swarm in the media every time a new online service entices us to share something about ourselves. They say we should fear the companies and technologies that use the bait of free content and services, improved social lives, personalization, and increased relevance to get us to open up. They fret about government, and they're right to, for government has the means to learn much about citizens and the power to use that knowledge against them. Privacy advocates worry for our young people, who they fear are saying too much. Bad things could happen, they warn. But then, bad things always could. Search Google News for privacy advocates, and in just one day you'll find no end of them quoted by media as an often anonymous tribe of chronic worriers. Privacy advocates howled. Privacy advocates cry foul. Privacy advocates are no doubt sharpening their arrows this morning. Facebook angers privacy advocates. E-retail law rankles privacy advocates. Privacy advocates, civil libertarians, and some social scientists are incredulous. Privacy advocates will now be watching closely. Consumers and privacy advocates are forever concerned about the ways they can be tracked online. They howl, cry foul, sharpen arrows, get angry, get rankled, are incredulous, are concerned, watch and fret, our privacy advocates. In his book, Understanding Privacy, Daniel J. Solove compiles our reputed fears about privacy, quoting The Naked Society's Vance Packard in 1964, who worried that privacy was evaporating, and also psychologist Bruno Bettelheim, who declared in 1968 that privacy is constantly under assault. Says Solove, "Countless commentators have declared that privacy is under siege and attack, that it is in peril, distress, or danger, that it is eroding, evaporating, dying, shrinking, slipping away, diminishing, or vanishing, and that it is lost or dead. Legions of books and articles have warned of the destruction, death, or end of privacy. As Professor Deborah Nelson has put it, privacy, it seems, is not simply dead. It is dying over and over again. Or is it? With all this talk of privacy, 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 we might well end up with more protection than ever, perhaps too much. Still, I fully affirm our right to privacy, the need for it to be protected, and the need for each of us to maintain our proper control over our information, creations, and identities. I will support the armies of self-anointed privacy advocates who argue these points on our behalf, though I will try to push past the excited rhetoric, speculative fears, and vague language of privacy, and examine what we mean when we talk about it. What is it that we need to keep private, and why? What is the harm done when privacy is violated? What are the roots of our fears about privacy? How do we correlate one another's different expectations of privacy? Why, for example, do some Germans object to Google Street View taking pictures of their buildings, while some Americans seek out the Google car to perform and have their pictures taken for all to see. Privacy and publicness are not mutually exclusive. Indeed, they depend upon each other. Public and private are relative terms, like hot and cold or light and dark, says Paul Kennedy, host of the CBC show Ideas. The one defines the other. Or as Michael Warner writes in Publics and Counterpublics, most things are private in one sense and public in another. A book, for example, is the public expression of private thoughts. We bring our private identities to our public acts. We decide in private where we stand on an issue, and making that public is what allows us to join with like thinkers, share our ideas, and organize action. At the same time, our public lives amid other people, hearing their ideas, arguments, and evidence, informs our private decisions. Publicness depends on privacy. Private and public are choices we make, to reveal or not, to share or not, to join or not. Each has benefits, each hazards. We constantly seek a balance between the two. Only today, technology brings...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.